Hello, I am Sarita, Assistant Professor, Department of CSC, SDMIT, Ujre. Today's topic, Shortest Job, First Scheduling Algorithm. First, we need to define Shortest Job, First Scheduling Algorithm. In this algorithm, the process having the smallest execution time is chosen for the next execution. That means, which are the process requesting the shortest CPU time, so that process selected first for execution. SJF exists with two different schemes. The first one is non-preemptive SJF. In non-preemptive scheduling, once the CPU cycle is allocated to process, the process holds it till it reaches a waiting state or terminated. That means, once you are allocating the CPU for the requested process, it acquired the CPU until its entire completion or voluntary release the CPU. Second method, preemptive SJF. A process with the shortest burst time begins execution. If a process with even a shorter burst time arises, the current process is removed or preempted from execution, and the shorter job is allocated the CPU cycles. For example, if two processes are there, P1, P2, P1 arrive at 0 and CPU time required 7 milliseconds, and P2 arrive at 1 and CPU time required 4 milliseconds. Initially, at the CPU time 0, only one process resided in a queue, so that is P1. That will be selected for scheduling. Once it will be complete 1 millisecond task, the next process will be arrived and it will be stored in a queue. Comparing the burst time, the P1 1 millisecond task will be completed, still it required 6 milliseconds, and P2 process requesting 4 milliseconds. Comparing the burst time, the P2 requesting the shortest time, so that process will be selected for execution. And it will be preempt the execution for P1 and reload the new program for execution. And shortest job first scheduling algorithm is optimal, and it gives the minimum average waiting time for a given set of process. Let us discuss one problem related to shortest job first. So these are the processes with the process ID P1, P2, P3 and P4. Arrival time 0, 2, 4, 5, and each process requesting the different burst time. Draw the Gantt chart and find average waiting time and average turnaround time. Initially, at the time 0, only one process will be reside in a queue. So that is P1. So the P1 is required 7 milliseconds. At the 0th millisecond, only one process will be in a queue, that is P1. So you can select that process for execution. According to the algorithm, the P1 is acquired total 7 milliseconds. That means it will be complete the entire execution. Once you are allocating the CPU, it never releases the CPU. At the timestamp 2, 4 and 5, P2, P3 and P4 is arrived. But according to the definition, P1 will be acquired total 7 milliseconds. Now in neither queue, P2, P3 and P4 process will be resided. In this case, shortest job first scheduling algorithm, which process will be requesting the shortest time among these? So now the P1 is requesting shortest time. So that process will be selected for scheduling. So it required only 1 millisecond task. After that, only two process will be resided, that is P2 and P4. If both process requesting the same CPU time, that means 4 milliseconds will be required. In this case, we can go for the arrival time column. That means which process will be requesting the minimum or least arrival time, or which process will be having the least arrival time. So based on that, you have to select. Now in this example, the P2 arrived at 2nd millisecond and P4 arrived at 5th millisecond. So that's why the P2 will be selected for execution. and total CPU time required 4, and now CPU time is at 8 millisecond. 8 plus 4 it become 12. The next only one process is pending in a queue, that is P4. After that P4 will be entered for the execution. So the total time will be required for P4 4, so 12 plus 16. So this is a representation of a Gantt chart according to the algorithm. Now we need to calculate average turnaround time and average waiting time. The average turnaround time means the total turnaround time divided by the total number of process, and average waiting time means the total waiting time divided by the total number of process. Now we can calculate the arrival time. We know the arrival time and burst time, and we already draw the Gantt chart. Based on the Gantt chart, we get to know that the completion time. First, we need to calculate the turnaround time. How to calculate turnaround time? The turnaround time means the completion time minus arrival time. So whenever you can calculate the completion time, you always observe your Gantt chart right hand side end. So that is when that process will be arrived in a CPU at last position. So that you could consider. So here the P4 will be arrived at 16, completed at execution 16 milliseconds. So that is the turnaround time, completion time. And P2 completed at 12, P2 is completed at 12th millisecond, that is the completion time. And P3 completion time become 8 and P1 completion time become 7. Now you have to subtract with the arrival time. So P1 is arrived at 0, 7 minus 0, 7. And P2 arrived at 2, 12 minus 2 equal to 10. And P3 arrived at 8, minus 4 equal to 4. And P4 arrived at 5th millisecond, subtract with the completion time, it become 9. Next, we need to calculate waiting time. The waiting time means turnaround time minus burst time. You already calculated the turnaround time and subtracted with the burst time. So here the P1, the burst time is 7 and turnaround time is 7. 7 minus 7 it equal to 0. When process P1 arrived in a queue, immediately get the CPU. So no waiting time. So that's why it becomes 0. And P2, the turnaround time 10 and arrived at and burst time is 4, so 6 milliseconds spent in a queue. And similarly, the P3 arrived at 4 and completion time become 4 and subtracted with the burst time, it will be spent 3 milliseconds in a waiting queue. And P4, the turnaround time is 9 and burst time is 4, so it will be spent 5 milliseconds in waiting queue. Next we have to calculate average turnaround time and average waiting time. You know the formula how to calculate average turnaround time. So average waiting time, the total turnaround time divided by the total number of process. Now in this case 7 plus 10 plus 4 plus 9 divided by 4, so it becomes 7.5 milliseconds. And average waiting time 0 plus 6 plus 3 plus 5 divided by 4, so it becomes 3.5 milliseconds. But in a practically, we are not able to implement SGF because we never predict the CPU time for arrived process. Thank you.